Welcome to Madison Church of Christ, and thank you for joining us for worship this morning. We have some announcements in your bulletin, the first of which is right after the service today, we're going to have a meeting downstairs for anyone even remotely interested in the Mexico mission trip in January of 2020. And so that's a trip for all ages if you want to go, and we're going to go down to Mexico and build a house together. And so like I said last week, if you're even remotely interested or have heard of Mexico before, then I encourage you to attend the meeting. We'll tell you about what the trip will be like. You'll have an opportunity to ask questions, and it will be brief. Tonight, there's youth group at the Nielsen's for junior high and high school students. We invite you to come to that. And this week, Roy Williams is going to be gathering up stuff for the Central Iowa Bible Camp auction that happens on April 13th. And we're going to try to deliver it either this Saturday or next Saturday, preferably this Saturday. So if you have something that you want to send to the Central Iowa Bible Camp auction, which is their main fundraiser for the year, let me or Roy know, and we'll try to get it picked up so we can take it out there. This Friday, Patty Lang wants to take a group to the movie Unplanned that's showing in Marshalltown Friday evening at 7 o'clock. If you're interested in going to that, please speak to her today about that. Next week, we were scheduled to have Brother Che from the Korea Christian Gospel Mission come by and talk to our church. In fact, he was coming stateside to talk to a number of churches, but Brother Che had some health issues, so he wasn't able to come over from Korea. And we are going to have a Korea Christian Gospel Mission Sunday School anyway next week, where we get to show you some videos and tell you about this mission that we support in Korea, about Brother Che and his son and the work that their family and the work that they do there. And so I just encourage you guys to come for a special Sunday school next week where we can talk about the Korea Christian Gospel Mission. Now we're going to go to a time of prayer.
Another thing to add to the prayer list, Dave DeVilder mentioned that in Haiti, they are experiencing a pretty severe drought. So some of us know Salonique. We can remember to keep them in our prayers for that. Joel's starting a new series today called Joy in the Psalms. I'd like to read from Ephesians on one reason we can have joy. It says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, having predestined for adoption as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, with which he has blessed us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth." Let's pray. Father, we thank you for a day to gather together as believers, as ones who share in redemption, who share the inheritance that you've given us. God, thank you for the joy that brings us. God, we ask that you lift up those who are struggling. God, just help them to find joy in you and everything that you give us. Be with us now. May this time of worship bless and honor you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand as we sing this morning?
Oh,
greet those around you this morning.
Filling every part of our brain. Almighty God, Father in heaven, we look forward to that glorious day when you come back and we are all gathered together with you. We thank you so much for sending your Son to die for us on the cross. For as we take these emblems, let us examine ourselves, our hearts, repent, turn back to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Together, we have spent some time looking at some of the difficult sayings of Jesus. And so we've taken the most challenging words of our Savior and tried to fit them into our puzzle of who he is and what he was here to do. We selected them precisely because they were the most jagged, the most difficult for us to incorporate into our understanding of who Jesus is, the ones that cut across the grain more than the other words of Jesus, that we may accept more freely. But in doing so, we covered only a small number of verses, only a small number of Jesus' teachings. And if we are to reflect only on a small set of Christ's words, especially his most difficult words, we are liable to repeat the original transgression for which the reflection on the hard sayings of Jesus was the remedy. That transgression being a myopic, inordinate focus on one aspect of God's truth spoken in His Word, to the detrimental relegation of another aspect of God's truth spoken in His Word. I must confess that my worry is that over the course of that time is that there is a particularly pernicious variety of this transgression that I may have encouraged. See, there is a tendency among some of the faith to focus on the harshest words of Scripture, to dwell on the most impugning, the most ascetic, the angriest words of God, and with them to darken the human spirit. It's a form of masochism to raise the specter of guilt and repeat the truth of our own inadequacy until we just have to sit still in exhaustion. You can see it in the believer who can't crack a smile, in the Christian who is too overwhelmed with rules to follow to enjoy the company of a friend. Such an inordinate focus can make sometimes the Christian faith look a lot like Fran McCaffrey on the wrong side of a blocked charge call. It's the gospel of don'ts and can'ts when it's triumphant over the gospel of does, do's, and goes. You can see it if you look closely sometimes. I've heard it spoken to my face. Some close to me, a relative of mine who looked at me once and said, "I'll come back to church someday, Joel. But I'm not ready to stop having fun yet." We're still waiting for Uncle Nick. I can see where they're coming from sometimes. If all Jesus said was, "I've come to bring fire to the earth, not peace but division," if all He said was, "Sell everything you have and give it to the poor," if all Jesus said was, "If your eye causes you to sin, then gouge it out," they would be right. But the same Savior that spoke these words, these difficult words, which we must accept as truth, also spoke these words, "I've come to give you life and life to the fullest." It's the same Savior who said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." It's the same Jesus who, after He had finished His entire earthly ministry of teaching and modeling for His disciples, was praying the night He was arrested, was praying to God. We have this 3-chapter-long prayer in the Gospel of John, and in it, he when He's talking to God, He says this to Him. He says, "I am coming to you now, but I say these things while I am still in the world, so that they may have the full measure of my joy within them." That's what Jesus wanted for His disciples, for His followers, to have this full measure of joy. Joy is to be the result of hearing Christ's words. Joy is the right response to reading God's word. Joy is a characteristic of true belief and understanding. And the measure in which you have it speaks volumes towards the measure of God's Spirit which you have embraced. Now, there's joy and good reasons to be joyful all across Scripture, in page after page. But for a short time, we will focus on some reasons for joy in the book of Psalms. Psalms is the hymn book of the Bible. The word psalm is a technical term in the Jewish language. It means a song sung to the accompaniment of music or instruments. The song sung to the accompaniment of instruments. The book itself is a collection of 150 songs, each of them its own poem, and nearly every one of them stands alone, completely independent of the song that comes before it and the song that comes after it. There are many different kinds of songs in this book. You'll know if you read through, you will read a song of lament followed by a song of praise and joy. There are songs of repentance. There are songs of personal anger. There are songs of praise. There are songs of worship used for specific occasions. Specifically, there are a number of psalms that are written for people who are approaching the temple of God in a procession. For us, as believers in Jesus Christ, the Psalter is a list of sanctioned prayers. Here, we can read words spoken through the Spirit of God, which we may proclaim with truth. Psalms helps us pray to God. It fills our mouth with words that the Spirit has declared to express our feelings to God, as the psalmist is doing. For almost any of life situations, be they trials or triumphs, there is a psalm befitting the moment. There is a psalm which you can pray to God that works and says the words you need to express. Many of these psalms are particularly good at expressing joy. It's something we learn when we read psalms, is that expressing joy and praising God is part of our faith. It's part of the way in which we are to respond to who God is and what He has done. As you read through, you'll encounter in the book of Psalms the words joy, praise, and rejoice with dizzying frequency. In each of these chapters, there is a particular reason or reasons for this elation. We're going to look closely at a few of those reasons and use the words of the psalmist to enliven the joy of God, to enliven the joy of God's Spirit within us. As a matter of introduction to the theme, I would direct your attention to the words on the screen from Psalm 33:1 and Psalm 95:1. Both of these places, both of these songs begin with an instruction to have joy. To have joy and sing about it. This morning, we'll be turning our attention to the reason for the psalmist's joy in both of these passages. In Psalm 33, it's because by the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, their starry host by the breath of His mouth. He gathers the water of the sea into jars. He puts the deep into storehouses. In Psalm 95, it says, "In His hands are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to Him. The sea is His, for He made it, and His hands formed the dry land." Our God is the Creator. And throughout the Psalms, we see a feeling, a constant presence of rejoicing at the idea that God made what we can see. That God made us and the world around us and the heavens above us. For the psalmist, that truth causes joy and happiness. The beauty of creation is frequently on the mind of the psalmist. There are whole chapters devoted to this idea, but then also, as you read through Psalms, you'll see that the imagery of joy and praise throughout the Psalms are related so often to natural phenomena, to natural objects. The presence of nature is ever present in the language of the psalmist. As we discussed in Sunday school this morning, that the natural phenomena and the majestic, powerful things which you see in nature become the content of how we envision the appearance of God. In the Psalms, it is not just a reflection on the beauty itself, or how good-looking the horizon is, or the forest, or the landscape, but Psalms contains rhapsodies of praise for the one who made it that way. The object of praise is not the beautiful nature itself, but the one who made it, the one who caused it to be that way. Nature as a creation and continuing work of God is a constant source of joy in the Psalms. In nature, both in the heavens and on the earth, the psalmist sees the majesty of God and is overwhelmed. We can see this in Psalms 8, where it says, Lord our God, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You've set your glory in the heavens. Through the praise of children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of them? Human beings that you care for them. Here the psalmist expresses the emotion which surely you're familiar with, the feeling of looking up at the stars, considering your own smallness, considering your own smallness in juxtaposition to the greatness and majesty of that which God made, the expansiveness and beauty of His creation. This joy expressed over nature in the Psalms is not just that God has made it, but that He sustains it. The psalmist understands that God was not only the designer of the beauty of the world around us, but He continually holds it up. He continually provides for its bounty and renewal. There are a number of psalms that highlight this theme of joy and praise resulting from God's natural creation. Psalm 8, 19, 33, 95. But 104, Psalms 104 stands out to me among all of them. We'll be reading from there this morning. Psalm 104 is a song of praise. At its end, the psalmist will characterize these words as a meditation of rejoicing. If you pay close attention while we read through this psalm, you'll notice that the psalmist is conscious of and tracking through the days of creation from Genesis chapter 1 as he reflects on the majesty of what God has done in creating the world around us. But here also in this chapter, you'll notice it's not just the creative act which gives joy to the psalmist, which causes him to praise God. Not just that God made it, but that God sustains it. The continual presence and influence of our Creator who loves us in His creation. In Psalm 104, we read this. Praise the Lord, my soul. Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty. The Lord wraps himself in light as with a garment. He stretches out the heavens like a tent and lays the beams of his upper chambers on their waters. He makes the clouds his chariot and rides on the wings of the wind. He makes winds his messengers, flames of fire his servants. He set the earth on its foundations. It can never be moved. You covered it with watery depths as with a garment. The waters stood above the mountains, but at your rebuke the waters fled. The sound of your thunder they took to flight. They flowed over the mountains. They went down into the valleys to the place you assigned for them. You set a boundary that they cannot cross. Never again will they cover the earth. He makes springs pour water into the ravines. It flows between the mountains. They give water to all the beasts of the field. The wild donkeys quench their thirst. The birds of the sky nest by the waters. They sing among the branches. He waters the mountains from his upper chambers. The land is satisfied by the fruit of his work. He makes grass grow for the cattle and plants for the people to cultivate, bringing forth food from the earth, wine that gladdens humans' hearts, oil to make their faces shine, and bread that sustains their hearts. The trees of the Lord are well watered, the cedars of Lebanon that he planted. There the birds make their nests. The stork has its home in the junipers. The high mountains belong to the wild goats. The crags are a refuge for the hyrax. He made the moon to mark the seasons, the sun knows when to go down. You bring darkness, it becomes night, and all the beasts of the forest prowl. The lions roar for their prey and seek food from their God. The sun rises and they steal away. They return to lie down in their dens. Then people go out to their work, to their labor until the evening. How many are your works, Lord? In wisdom you made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. There is a sea, vast and spacious, teeming with creatures beyond number, living things, both large and small. There are the ships that go to and fro, and the Leviathan, which you formed to frolic there. All creatures look to you to give them their food at the proper time. When you give it to them, they gather it up. When you open your hand, they are satisfied with good things. When you hide your face, they are terrified. When you take away their breath, they die and return to the dust. When you send your spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the ground. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. He who looks at the earth and it trembles, who touches the mountains and they smoke, I will sing to the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. May my meditation be pleasing to him as I rejoice in the Lord. But may sinners vanquished from the earth and the wicked be no more. Praise the Lord, my soul. Praise the Lord. When the psalmist considered what God had made and the beauty and bounty of the world in which we live, he considered it praise to the Lord. He considered it a meditation of joy. So too for us is God's creation a source of joy. So too when we see the beauty of nature, the beauty of the world around us, we should take heart and receive joy from God. When you see the spring dawning and hear the birds chirping and the trees budding, will you rejoice in the God who made it and the God who even now holds it in his hands? Now here's a tricky thing about nature. Its beauty is shared with the wicked in the same measure that it is given to the righteous. Both the evil and the upright enjoy the sunset. But as you read Psalms, as we have here in Psalm 104, you'll see that the joy expressed here is one with a uniquely Christian dimension, is one that requires and depends on the truths that we hold from God's word about the Christian faith for it to be truly enjoyed. You will not share in the psalmist's joy over creation unless you love the Father who created and sustained it. To the skeptic, the beauty of nature is a mistake. To the deist who imagines God to be far off, nature is a beautiful design that has been left uncared for and has now run amok. To the soul who thinks that God is sinister, the beauty of nature is a tease which will soon expire with time and deprive us of another joy. To the naturalist, it becomes an idol, a god unto itself. Such a theory, that of the naturalist, must accept the beauty of nature alongside its cruelty and declare them as both good. And there we see the second trick of nature's beauty is that sometimes it's absent. The creation of God that we experience today is not always good and certainly not always beautiful. The nature which we experience presents both the cherry blossom and the ash borer, the babbling brook and the flu virus, the gentle breeze and the tsunami. That's because the wickedness of mankind's sin has caused God's beautiful creation to be subjected to futility, broken and at times harsh. As believers, we recognize that there is another force at work in nature. We see more than just the beauty of God's creation and the wonders of God's sustainment in our nature, in the world that surrounds us. At times, we also see the power of evil and the corruption and the brokenness that permeates not just the human heart and the human mind, those weren't the only victims of the fall from the Garden of Eden, but also the natural world which God created for our pleasure. That too has fallen. In God's Word, we are told that the nature we experience here and now on this side of Eden is a mix. It's a jumble of God's created beauty and gracious provision on one hand together in the same place as the darkness that has resulted from our rebellion against God. It is the Christian faith that teaches us these things. In God's Word, it's the account of creation, fall, redemption, and salvation which can order all of this for us. In Romans 8, we read this about God's creation. Starting in verse 18, I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of God. It is through this story, this large, meta, overarching story of what the world consists of, provided by God's Word, the truth of Scripture, by which we can understand and appreciate the beauty of nature and reject the brokenness and evil that we find there as a rebellion that will one day be conquered by our Creator. So what is the natural world now to us in this moment? To the skeptic, it's a mistake. To the deist, it is uncared for. For the wicked, it's only a tease. To the naturalist, it's an idol. But to the believer, to the sons and daughters of God through faith in Jesus Christ, it is beauty. When we can recognize and see past the evil that has been brought to our world by sin, we can see the beauty with which God created the place in which we live, the magnificence of His works, His power to create something that is better than we can imagine. And when we perceive it, we know that it is a foretaste. Knowing that God's goodness, which we see in part, which we smell in part, which we taste, touch, and hear in part now, will be our full future destiny fully realized in God's eternal kingdom. So let this truth give your heart joy, that one day the beauty you see around you in the natural world, which we catch in glimpses, in moments, one day this beauty, which He has created and sustains even now, will be set free from the corruption of death, decay, and violence to which it has been subjected and will be our home for all time. God is our Creator and the Creator of everything we see around us. His creation is beautiful, and that should give us joy. That is reason for gladness. May the experience of the beauty and bounty in nature be for you a meditation of rejoicing, as it was for the psalmist. Pray with me. Dear God, we love you. Dear God, when we see what you have made, we understand, we realize both how small we are and how great is your power. Dear God, you're the one who made the stars stretch out across the sky. and who made this world for us as a home. Dear God, for the beauty and for the provision that comes through it, we give you praise. Dear God, together, as your children, we look forward to the day when it will be set free and restored to the purpose for which you created it. Dear God, for each of us in this room, I pray that you will fill our hearts with joy at the perception of your creation and the recognition that you are both creator and sustainer. Pray this in your name. Amen.
Would you stand as we close today?
Thank you.